Good morning, Phoenix, and welcome to the House of Mystery radio show. This is the place to come for true crime, conspiracy, and alternative history. Only on KFNX 1100 Independent Talk Radio. We're here every Saturday morning, 6 to 7 a.m., and I'm your host, Al Warren. We are back in the House of Mystery, and today we're going into the dark waters, as we call them. We have a special guest, first time on the show, and we're glad to have him, Mr. Dark Waters. Thanks for coming on the show.
I appreciate you having me on, and I'm honored to have an opportunity to share some of my scary stories with your listening audience. I think they'll be delighted with some of the content that I've been able to create and gather and put together. I think they'll love it.
Oh, I'm sure they're into that. So, first of all, for an introduction to the listeners, if they don't know who you are, how did you get into doing what you're doing and your YouTube channel and the whole thing? Like, where did it all start for you?
Well, it started about I think it started in November of last year. I was looking at a way of using my skill set, which was background in radio. Background in entrepreneurism, and then just my past experience in paranormal experiences. And I was like, oh, I listened to a lot of guys on YouTube who told horror stories, and I would listen. I was like, that's really not scary. You know, it's really not scary at all. So what I decided to do was give it a shot at presenting to people the content that I have. And all my stories are true stories that are 99%, I'd say 95 to 99% verified at this point in time, because it's getting a little looser because I'm taking subscriber stories. And so my process is I sit down with a person either face-to-face via Skype or on the phone, and I interview them about what happened to them, you know, their encounter, their experience. And I turn around, I take that, and I formulate it into their story. And then I bring that story to life in an audio dramatization format, which is what people really love. And it's real high quality, it's very, very high quality version of a horror story. It's almost like closing your eyes and listening to a movie. And that's what I go for. I'll go for you laying in the bed with your eyes closed with Netflix on, but that same feel, but it's my show. So, and people love it. They absolutely love it.
Where do you find your stories? Like, how do you go out and find them?
The initial story started from just my network of friends. So when I started the Dark Waters channel, I had a email list of 3,000 people just from the things I did in business and the things I did around the city of New Orleans. And so I sent out emails to my network asking people about some of their paranormal experiences and things that went wrong in their lives. And it started off, the first story I actually got wasn't a scary story. It was a story about from a friend of mine who was the longest running undercover DEA agent and he was in San Diego. And that was the actual first story I got. And while I was talking with him about his stories and taking the notes and going over the finer details, then for me started sharing a story with me about his dogman encounter that he had here in New Orleans. And so the way I get my stories is pretty much mano a mano, the people that I know and the people that I can come in contact with. Now it's transformed to, it's a little bit more loose because there are subscribers that want to tell me stories. And then I go through the process with those subscribers where either I have multiple phone conversations with them, up to 9 or 10 phone conversations with them, and have them tell me the story over and over and over again. And I kind of interrogate them in a nice way and pull out the bits and pieces of their stories that make sense, or the bits and pieces of their stories that actually are marketable, and then I put it together. Then they go back and they approve the story and say, hey, this is exactly what happened, and then we go from there.
Wow. That's pretty incredible. So what do you find to be the scariest of stories? Like, what direction is it from, like, creatures and dogmen, or is it vampires, or where does it come from, the scariest?
I think the scariest thing about, and what makes the stories good, is not necessarily the creature itself, whether it be a dogman or a Bigfoot or black-eyed kids or ghosts. What actually makes the story scary is the human reaction, the reaction of the person. And I think that's why I've been successful where, and, you know, getting on Coast to Coast AM and Darkness Radio and shows like yours, which I appreciate being on, is because I don't really focus on the creature. I focus on the person. And so if you were telling me about your encounter about vampires, right, we all know that it's either you're going to believe that vampires exist or you're not going to believe that they exist. That's fine. I can't convince anyone about the creature, but what I can do is I can convince people about that person that's telling the story or the story that the person told me. And so I'm not dodging your question. I'm just giving you a very long roundabout answer to it. I'm going around a corner to tell you this, that if you focus on the individual who had the encounter, it pulls and captures all the emotions that make each and every creature come alive, whether it's a dog man, whether it's a vampire, whether it's a Bigfoot. The emotions that the person goes through are what brings out that encounter. So it makes each of them equally frightening because it's about the emotions as opposed to about the creature. Now, to answer your question, the most scary and frightening story I've heard would have to be a dogman story. That's some of the scariest stuff that I've ever heard, because we're talking about a 7-foot walking werewolf or wolfman that's fast as lightning, muscular and big and aggressive. That is some of the scariest stuff I've heard. And then secondary to that are the things that human beings do to each other, like the Katrina horror stories that I have 10 Katrina horror stories on the Dark Waters channel. Those things are very, very scary because it's us doing it to each other. And it just gives you an insight into the psyche of human beings and how evil we can be. So that's pretty much I can say on that one.
That's enough. And, you know, and it's true about humans can be real, real, real bad to each other. It's not pretty. Now, New Orleans has quite the history. There's been a lot of things that have happened there, you know, just so many bad things. Has this changed your opinion of what people are, and also of things like if vampires exist, or the dogmen, or anything like that? Has it changed how you feel about that?
About the city itself, or
just
about the city of New Orleans?
Well, kind of the combination. Like, so before you started getting into this and doing these stories and researching, has it changed your belief now that you've talked to a lot of people and have a lot of stories posted?
Absolutely. So the metamorphosis that I went through has been one. It's, I would call it an awakening, because the average person day to day who gets up and goes to work, you know, if they have kids, they're rushing their kids to school, they're trying to get to Starbucks, they're getting to the office, they're dealing with the bad boss, or then they get home, they got to deal with the wife, the kids. You know, there's this clutter of all these things that go on in your day to day life, right? And so I believe that clutter of day to day it creates a governor in our mind that does not allow us to comprehend and believe certain things, right? Because your mind is so packed with all this important things that you need to do. When something paranormal presents itself, you really don't have not the mental capacity, but you don't have the extra space or extra data space in your mind to try and figure all that out. Well, what's happened to me since I started doing this is I've started to open up and really understand that not only does this exist, and not only is it out there, but it's happening to everyday people. And I'm talking about it's happening to the girl who's walking to school in the morning by herself. It's happening to the district attorney. It's happening to the truck driver. It's happening to the milkman. It's happening to the mailman. And so what it's done is it's kind of opened me up to understanding that not only are we all subjected and open to these type of experiences, but also I need to be aware of ways to protect myself from these type of things. And one of the things that you'll hear me say repeatedly over and over is that I don't go to haunted locations. I don't go inside of them. And I've actually doubled down on that. I'm so far, like, if your house is haunted, I'm not going to stand in front of your house. I'm going to stay across the street from your house. Because I've had so many stories come to me about people who've encountered bad things that it's just, I have to do a better job of protecting myself. So that's how it's affected me personally. But it's also done something for me as well. That's a great thing. And that great thing is, it's given me an opportunity to kind of retake a look at my faith in God and things that I was doubting for a very long time. Because at some point in time, we all go through a process of growth where, you know, there is a loss. When you see the world for what it is, when you see the disasters, when you see ISIS, when you see hurricanes, when you see all these bad things going on, it's like you have a faith meter that kind of drops a bit, right? Yeah. And then some things happen that kind of bump that meter up. Well, for a person like me who's been involved in a lot of different ventures, knows people all over the world, and I knew people before I started doing this all over the world and had a lot of access and a lot of exposure, my meter dropped significantly, right? Well, since these things have happened and I've talked to people and I can verify that these things have happened, you have no choice but to believe in something greater than you now. Because what else are you going to believe in? If Dog Man is real, and you know he's real, which I do know. Some people may not believe that. If Bigfoot is real, then I know it's real. If Black Eyed Children are real, well, what else is real? Well, if all these bad entities are real, if evil exists, then good absolutely has to exist. So that's me kind of bearing my soul for your audience and just telling about the biggest change that's happened to me. And it's a positive change, and I really like that that's happened.
Well, that's good. Now, one of the stories I find very interesting, or an account, is the one of the angry man, which is something that's kind of for New Orleans only, isn't it? It's not something everywhere.
No, so the angry man, and just to give you guys all the inside baseball on that, when I found out I was going to go on Coast to Coast AM, I wanted to go to a location-specific haunting that I could get some information on. The guy who owns Sabiza's restaurant in the French Quarter, this is a friend of mine, I've known him for 13 years. And the backstory is, when he first bought that restaurant, it was right around Mardi Gras time, and we always do this party on Bourbon Street for Mardi Gras. So he was like, hey, I bought this haunted restaurant, bro, let's go check it out. And it's like 1 o'clock in the morning. I'm like, you know, I really don't do the whole haunted thing. He's like, come on, let's go check it out. Well, the freaky stuff with Sabiza started that night, and I haven't really told people these stories. We go, we park, we go over to Sabiza's restaurant, and he has the key, and he's trying to unlock the door. And it's on Decatur Street. It's a very, very busy thoroughfare downtown in the French Quarters. And so he unlocks the door and tries to push it open, but it's locked again. Then he unlocks it again. We hear it click and tries to push it open, but it locks again. Now, he's not turning the key. The door is locking itself. And so this happens about 4 or 5 times. I'm like, listen, bro, I'm not really interested in going in here. Let's go to the party. Let's hang out. So when it came time to get some really, really, really good stuff for the Coast to Coast AM story, I turned to him. And I went on a tour of the restaurant. I talked to the historian, Graham, and he and I had long conversations. He gave me the history of the restaurant, and it's more than an angry man there. There's a ghost named Mary. That I had an encounter with while I was there, which reinforced the reason why I don't go back in these places. There's Mary's son. But the angry man is the dark entity that haunts that location. And that location was a speakeasy and a place of prostitution and sex slavery. Well, the main mistress, I don't know what you call the woman who runs a prostitution ring. The word eludes me right now.
Madam?
Well, she had a son. The madam, that's the word, the madam. So the madam's son is the ghost of the angry man. The angry man is his ghost, essentially. And he was known to abuse the women, the most young, beautiful women that they had that were there. And so it's his spirit. I can't remember the name off the top of my head, but if I was sitting in front of a computer or notes, I could pull it up. But it's his spirit that's the angry man. And so when you go inside this restaurant today, if you go today right now, you will find that there are no women working in this restaurant anywhere. It's all men. This is probably one of the few places in the French Quarter where there's oodles of foot traffic going around that you will not find a female working in the restaurant. You won't find a female working there at all. It's all men working in the restaurant because every woman that has worked there has been ran out of the building by this entity, the Angry Man. So the story that I told about the Angry Man is this. There was a young lady who was a tour guide, and they do haunted tours of the restaurant because the restaurant really is haunted. So they do about 40,000 tours a year through this restaurant. And so the young lady was a tour guide. Her and her boyfriend were at his house in Covington, Louisiana. And Covington is right at about 50 miles outside of the city of New Orleans. She's in a swimming pool. She's swimming. She's trying to relax. She feels she's away from the restaurant and away from all the drama and away from all the troubles that she was having with the Angry Man because he had followed her to her house in the city of New Orleans, and she was seeing him around the house. Well, as she's swimming through the pool, swimming underwater, she looks up, and she thinks she sees the shadow of her boyfriend standing by the side of the pool. And as you know, if you're swimming underwater, if you can imagine being underwater, kind of, you know how it's kind of hazy where you look up, you think you can see a figure above the water, but she wasn't sure, but she thought it was him. So she jumps out of the water trying to splash him, but when her eyes clear from the water, it's this black shadow standing over her looking down at the edge of the pool. So she dives back into the water, starts screaming, and basically starts drowning. Her boyfriend comes running out, dives in the pool, and saves her. Now, they have a very interesting conversation after that, and I've talked to both her and him. And he didn't believe her at first. He just figured, you know, she was under too much stress. He had never seen this thing. He had never experienced anything. So he figured she was just stressed out. And later that night, while they're in bed, cuddling, snuggled up, you know, spooning each other, he gets choked by this spirit, the Angry Man. And he physically sees this dark shadow over him. He feels his chest and his neck and his entire upper body having this pressure that he described to me as if someone had set a ton of bricks on his chest and he couldn't breathe. And all he could think to do was start praying to, he said, all he could think to do was start praying. And as he started praying and she started praying, the figure moved away from them into the wall, up to the top of the side of the wall, like in a corner of the room, up the wall. And it hasn't been back since. But at the same time, the Angry Man is probably one of the few stories I have where an entity, a negative entity, has followed a person home multiple times. It really is a scary, scary concept and idea. And just to think, prior to really knowing about this story, I had just told my girlfriend, I said, hey, we're going to go have dinner, you know, at Sabiza's. Yeah. She was like, great, it's an awesome idea. That won't be happening. No. You know?
Yeah, not a good idea. No.
No.
How do the people in the city react? So was there a strong belief in a lot of the paranormal in New Orleans?
You know, that's a great question. And I get that question all the time. And the best way to explain it is this. You know, for most people, the paranormal is something that's foreign to them, right? Hmm. So if I was to ask you, you know, what do you guys do for Thanksgiving dinner, right? You probably say, hey, you know, we cook, we all sit around, we eat, you know, we have a few beers, a few glasses of wine, and then we watch a football game, then everybody goes their own separate ways. And that's typical. That's the same thing that happens here in New Orleans, except for inside the conversations that happen during the football game, over dinner, people start opening up and telling about these different little paranormal experiences that they've had. And it's not a negative thing. It's not a frightening thing. It's just something that people know about and that we live with down here. So it's not like it's this shocking, overwhelming thing that happens. It's just how it is here in New Orleans because of the history of the city. You're talking about buildings and houses that are 200-300 years old. You're talking about a French Quarter that was, we go back to the 1800s. I mean, thousands of lives lived and lost in this one city. So you have traumatic events like Hurricane Katrina that happened. And before Hurricane Katrina, Hurricane Betsy. So, you know, it's just something that it's a part of the culture here is what I'm trying to say. You know, even if you go back to as far back as to things like the founding of the French Quarters and the settling of different areas of the city and how different areas were settled on the highest points and the highest ground, because back in those days, areas would flood and people were killed. So it's just a part of our culture. It really is. It's a part of our culture just like gumbo is, just like red beans and rice, just like crawfish. It's just a part of our culture. And when you talk to the average New Orleanian and you really get them talking, pretty much everybody's got a little bit of a story to tell you. It's just a matter of knowing how to get people to talk.
Do you think that all of these kind of major events like Katrina and things like that, do you think that they actually bring out these creatures or attract them? Or is it the other way around? Is the creatures attracting the events?
Oh, that's a good question. I've never been asked that question. I think the only way to answer that is in reference to what I've been told and what I personally experienced. If we talk about Hurricane Katrina for a second and what happened during Hurricane Katrina, I was in this city when it was void of life and it felt like it was dead and it had this evil feeling to it, like the air was thick. It was a sense of dread and doom no matter which way you went. It was a horrible thing, right? And my belief is that negative entities do feed off misery and off death and off loss, right? So for the couple of years after Katrina hit, and I ran a construction company here all the way up until 2012, where we gutted houses, we rebuilt houses, we did all these things, that feeling was still there, and it really was around the city. When the city started charging back and started coming back, that feeling went away. And I can actually put a time stamp on kind of when that gloomy feeling went away. There was a football game that the Saints played here in the city where they played the Falcons. The guy, I can't remember this guy's name. He's, ever since this happened, he ended up, I think he has multiple sclerosis, or it's a disease where you can't use a certain part of your body at a specific time, right? He was a defensive cornerback or one of the defensive positions. Well, the Saints are playing the Falcons. It's a tie game, the first game back in the Superdome, and the Falcons are kicking a field goal to win the game. His name is Gleason. I can't remember his first name. I think it may be Mark Gleason. But he blocks that field goal. The Saints win. The city is energized. The energy in the city comes back. It's so alive from that point moving forward. It was home again. Prior to that moment, and I can honestly say prior to that moment, and somebody would say, oh, he's talking crazy, he's talking about a sports event. But when you talk about positive and negative energy balance, that moment was bigger than just a sports victory. It was a moment of victory for the city of New Orleans. I think it was a victory moment of good over evil for the city of New Orleans, because it was an energizing moment for everybody who lived here, who loved this place, who believed in this place. And when you start talking about the New Orleans Saints, our football team, we're not talking about just the city of New Orleans. We're talking about the surrounding area, the Gulf South region, which is everything that was hit by Hurricane Katrina. So I think that's the best way I can answer. I think that these negative entities do feed off of that type of energy. And I think there was a balance that was off. But at the same time, there wasn't many people here to experience a lot of that negativity, with the exception of those who were left behind, like military contracts and people like myself who came back. So
yeah,
I think that's the best way to answer that one.
And some of the history, like with voodoo and hoodoo and that, how does that play into it?
Well, when you start talking about voodoo, when you start talking about hoodoo, again, that's a part of our culture. And it's such a part of our culture that one of the places that I just recently visited to do a story was the Voodoo Spiritual Temple. Is right on Rampart Street down here. So when you talk about voodoo and hoodoo, those things are definitely mixed into our culture. Now, how they affect our culture is a different story. Because if you know anything about voodoo and you know anything about hoodoo, they're two completely different things. But if you know anything about voodoo, it's not necessarily a bad thing. I mean, it gets a bad rap, but it's not necessarily a bad thing. People go to voodoo people, they go to voodoo priests for money. They go for love. They go for all kinds of different little spells, right? Now you get into hoodoo, you start getting into some darker things. And there are stories of people actually going to hoodoo or voodoo priestess to try and get them to do things to other people. But on a whole scale, if we're talking about 100% of the pie, and we have to divide that pie up, I would say that's 10% of what goes on down here. You got to add in ghosts. That's another 20%, which I just got a story today. A young lady wants me to call her. She wants to tell me a story about a ghost that chased her boyfriend out of the house. They broke up because a ghost chased them away, because it was a male ghost that liked her and ran him off. You got to talk about crazy people who do insane things here in New Orleans that you just won't find out. You won't find out about those things unless you know about them. Like Zach and Addie, that story from after Katrina. Then you got to get into the vampire stuff where the psychic vampires in the French Quarter. It's like this big, huge gumbo of different things and different entities and different energies that make this city like a paranormal gumbo. And that's what I think that's the best way to describe it. It's a paranormal gumbo. So no one thing in particular makes this place what it is. It's the mixture of everything. It's the fact that you can go to New Orleans East, which is where I grew up, and it's about 15-minute ride from here, and people are having dogman encounters, right? And you can go to the French Quarters, which is a 5-minute ride from where I'm standing right now, and people are having ghost encounters, shadow people encounters, black-eyed kid encounters, and vampire encounters, right? So it's just the makeup of this city.
Yeah. Have you had any personal experiences with anything yourself?
I have plenty of personal experiences. I'll give you an older one that happened to me when I was in high school. I used to babysit. And I'll never forget this because this little kid loved me to death. I was a senior in high school. I was buffed. I played football. I was like all-city linebacker and star baseball player. And he looked up to me, and I went by his parents' house to babysit him. And I used to wear this Superman T-shirt, so he would always be all over me. I love you, Superman. I love you, Superman. And so, but he was a little bad kid. Wasn't bad to the point to where, you know, he needed a spanking, but you just had to tell him stuff over and over again. And so it's time to settle him in there that night. And I'm chasing him around the house. Like, come on, man, you got to get in the bed. You got to get in the bed. He's like, I'm going to bed, Superman. So finally, I get him upstairs. I get him into his room. And I come back downstairs, and I turn on TV. I think I was either watching The Golden Girls or watching Murder, She Wrote. One of the two, which is, by the way, is two of my favorite stories, shows, Golden Girls and Murder, She Wrote. People will never know that, but I love The Golden Girls, right? So I'm watching a TV show, and out of the corner of my eye, I see him run around the steps and run into the kitchen. And I'm like, and I get up and I'm cursing like, boy, didn't I tell you to get in the bed? I run, sprint around the steps into the hallway where the kitchen is and turn into the kitchen. He's not there. But I know I saw him. I wasn't drinking. I wasn't high on drugs. I wasn't drinking any alcohol. I was sitting there drinking lemonade. I know I saw him. So I go upstairs. I'm running up the steps trying to check on him. He's in the bed. His brother's leg is on top of his chest. It couldn't have been him. It wasn't him. It was something else, right? So when his parents get home, they're like, oh, how did everything go? And I said, everything went well. I had something strange happen. And his dad comes outside to pay me as I'm going to the car. And I tell him what happened. He was like, that's happened to me before, too. He said, that's the other little boy who lives in our house. I was like, wow, okay. You could have told me that before I came over here. Yeah. So I've had things happen to me.
Yeah, you could have charged
strange and paranormal.
You could have charged him for extra babysitting.
Yeah, it's an extra kid I had to take care of.
Yeah. That's just amazing. So what's the vampire stories going on there?
Well, I'll give you the background of vampire story because there's a stopping point that I have to, I've been warned about this, so there's a stopping point for it. I did a story from a New Orleans police officer here locally that when he approached me and we started talking, he said that he was a part of a task force in the city of New Orleans who dealt with paranormal things that happened, right? So essentially there were regular officers who run at the bad guys, right, with guns and stealing cars. And then there's these other couple of guys, six of them in total, maybe four of them, I think, in total. At this point in time, five of them, to be completely honest and accurate. They were the ones who got the calls for the crazy stuff, right? If it was a repeated call to a house where somebody said something paranormal was happening, they got those repeated calls. Well, he gives me his first story about a hellhound and a coven. I think it's the proper word is a coven of witches that operated right outside of the French Quarters. And then I asked him about, has he ever experienced anything with vampires? He was like, sure, I'll tell you about the vampires. I'm like, so we really do have vampires? He's like, of course we do. And so he goes in to tell me about vampires and educate me on it. He says, well, there are two types. He said, there's types that are that actually they don't suck blood, but they need blood for energy. And he told me the name, and I can't remember. It's Segway or Segway. The name eludes me, but I can look it up and tell you the name. And he said, there's another type that's a psychic vampire that psychically takes energy. And he said, we don't have the blood-sucking ones here. He said, we did back in the days, in the early founding days of New Orleans, but we don't have that anymore. He said we have covens or houses of these psychic vampires that actually will seduce someone and drain their life force. And I was like, well, I thought your blood was your life force. He was like, yes, your blood is your life force. He was like, but also everything is created out of energy. We all are nothing but balls and bundles of energy. And that blood that pumps through our veins, that circulates through our body and our heart, is like an engine, and it pumps this energy, this form of energy. That's why your body gets hot. Then he went to the whole physics of everything, right? So I'm really excited about this guy telling me all this stuff and me being able to do these stories. And so he tells me about a young lady who has an encounter at a barroom. She meets this guy, 6'4", black guy, that's the most handsome man she's ever seen. And she feels drawn to him, and she ends up leaving the barroom with him. Her girlfriends are there. They're having a girls' night out. She just walks out with him. And they go down the street. This is at the Blacksmith's Bar, which I can tell this, the location of it now, because I've talked to the owner of Blacksmith. He didn't have a problem with this. But it's at the Blacksmith's Bar, which is on Bourbon Street. They leave. They go down the street, leave out of the side door, go down the street, headed towards Rampart, cross the street, go into a courtyard. And she said inside of this courtyard were people kind of sitting around, and she's like, there's certain people look like they were in just a daze. And I was like, well, was somebody sucking blood? She's like, no, it was just as if they were close to each other. You know, they were smelling each other. They were just close to each other, like they were in full contact, but they weren't having sex, but they were just close to each other, unnormally and unusually close. So she starts to get freaked out, and the guy who she's with tries to get her to go inside the house that's in a courtyard. And her senses kick in, and she's like, no, I'm not going in there. And she leaves, right? But when she gets back to the barroom, this guy's already there. So I get that story from him. I talk to him about it, and I'm like, okay, man, that's a great story. I really want you to give me more. Who are they? Where are they from? All these other things, right? We get off the phone. I said, look, I'll call you tomorrow. We'll talk more about it. I call him the next couple of days. He's not answering the phone. He finally calls me back. He says, hey, you're not going to be able to do that story. And I was like, why? He's like, well, some people have found out of what I told you about what I told you, and they don't want that information out there. Turns out that not only did his bosses not want the information out there, but there were some high-level city officials that didn't want that information out there because it was a tourism-based economy. So unfortunately, I had to stop all my digging into it because I didn't have a source anymore, and I don't have a source. Like, when I say I'm blackballed out of that, like, I went to the French Quarters and talked to people who supposedly know. Nobody talks to me about it. I'm completely blackballed out of it at this point in time. So it just lets me know that there's a significant amount of truth there, and these are some very powerful people. And the only thing I've been able to gather is that the people who are into this are some of the wealthiest people in the city of New Orleans. And I've been told one or two names, which I don't dare say because I don't want any problems with people who have significant more money than me, because yeah, I don't need those kind of enemies, you know? I really don't.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, for sure. So do you think that the vampires are traditional like we see in Hollywood, or is it something different?
To be honest with you, I don't think it's anything like what we see in Hollywood. From what's been explained to me, there is no like kind of pale, creepy skin or anything like that. It's a regular looking person, except for they feed off of your life force energy. And, you know, in martial arts, they call it chi. In different arenas around the world, they have a different name for the energy that flows through our body, but it's regular looking people. But that's what they feed off of, and their success is tied to that. And that's what I've been told. But I really can't tell you anymore because nobody won't tell me anymore. I'm serious. They won't. They won't tell me anything. I've been trying, bro. You don't understand how hard. But nobody won't tell me anything else. I'm like, I'm literally blackballed in that community here.
Wow. That's kind of crazy in itself. You have to wonder if there's something more to it than just PR and, you know, selling to tourists. You know, there's...
You know what? That's a good point you said that. Let's touch on that. So, of course, when we talked about Sabizas, right, I told you that there were these tour companies that, and New Orleans has a whole tourism industry based on haunted tours, swamp tours, ghost tours, all this other stuff. One of the guys at Sabizas, Graham, who's the historian for the restaurant, I was like, Graham, tell me about the vampires, right? Because, again, I had been blackballed, so I'm like, okay, this guy's going to tell friend. he's the official historian. He's going to tell me something, all right? I said, but Graham, tell me about the vampire stories that people are saying around here. And he was like, well, to be honest with you, man, he was like, 75% of the stuff that these people tell on these tours is made up. I was like, what do you mean? He was like, if you pay for a tour where they walk you around the street, 75% of the stuff is made up. He was like, now 25% of it is true. He was like, but out of that 25%, there's 10% that's the absolute truth that nobody will tell you, nobody will share with you. I said, why don't you share with me? He was like, I don't know the 10%. He's like, I listen to your stories, and you have more of the truth than I ever have. I was like, oh, okay. So there's a certain portion of this that's, I believe, that's marketing. I believe when people start talking about the vampires here, and it's perpetuated because it's an economy to where people make money off of it, right? But then there's a certain portion of it when we start talking about this officer who I know for a fact did this until he retired. He's not lying. He's just not lying. So there's that portion of truth. Now, where they meet and where they separate is the real question, and that's what I was trying to really dig into, but I haven't been able to. And I really will continue to try and dig into it in the safest way possible, but it's just that's the dividing line. So is there some stuff out here that's not true? Absolutely. Is there stuff that PR and marketing? Absolutely. Is some of that stuff probably disinformation as well? Probably too. You know, probably there's some disinformation mixed in there just for the simple fact that the concept of there being psychic vampires or blood-sucking vampires around that live for a long time, right? Mm-hmm. Wouldn't they be smart enough to use different disinformation tactics as well? So, yeah. Yeah, I'm running my mouth now, but that's kind of where I stand on that.
Yeah, no, it's true. And so now you've mentioned black-eyed children and things. How is the stories of the black-eyed children? How do you get them and kind of what's the typical story you get?
I've had several black-eyed children stories. The first ones that I got were all from people who were from that original email list. I had a story about a black-eyed attorney who... The young lady who had this encounter had it. She worked for, almost said the judge's name, but she worked for a civil court judge here locally. The black eyed kid encounter that I had, which is not too far from where I live, was from a family whose kids played flag football with my kids, right? And then the worst black eyed kid encounter that I'm going to share with you actually happened to a woman who used to work at the nursery where my kids attended before Hurricane Katrina. And so she shared that with me. She shared her story with me, and it probably is the most frightening black eyed kid encounter I've ever heard. Now, I preface this story with this. I do not know what black eyed children are. I don't think anybody really knows what they are. There's speculation that they're demons, there's speculation that they're aliens. When Dave Schrader and I had a conversation, Dave leaned to the side, well, they were an omen and only an omen, and they were there to tell you about negative things to come, similar to kind of a banshee predicting death or things of that nature. So I do not know the answers as to what they are. I don't ever want to encounter them myself because this is a stand your ground state, and I'll probably shoot one of them. But it's one of those things to where I can't answer exactly what they are, but I can tell you the stories of what have happened to people and how it's affected them. So the lady, Miss Pat, who used to work at the nursery my kids were at before Hurricane Katrina, she was one of the people who actually called me after she got an email and started sharing her story with me. She lives in Nashville, Tennessee now, and she had never been outside of the city of New Orleans, never lived. And Miss Pat is like 60 years old, never lived outside of the city. And so moving to Nashville, she moved from an all-majority city to a city that's way more diverse. And she was really, really kind of being embraced by the community. And she lived in an apartment complex that was right across the street. And I say lived because she's moved since then. In the past 2 weeks, she's moved. She lived in an apartment complex that was right across from a park. And Miss Pat watched kids. I'm talking about when I talk about a woman who babysits, like she would watch kids at the nursery. They get off work and babysit your kids for you when you went to dinner or when you wanted to go out to the club, whatever you wanted to do. She would watch your kids, right? So she loves children. She's at home. She's waiting on the maintenance man to come and work on her dishwasher. And she's anticipating that this maintenance man will come. So she's going moving from one room to another room in the apartment, headed towards the kitchen. There's a knock at the door. She opens the door, and just opens it and says, come in, thinking it's the maintenance man. Now, she's in a phenomenally great neighborhood. She has no reason to really worry. And this woman was in a very, very rough neighborhood in New Orleans because I dropped off many a time. So her guard is completely down. She opens the door, says, come in. And as she's walking towards the kitchen, she gets this eerie feeling like, you know, something's wrong. And what she told me, she was like, you know, I didn't want to look over my shoulder. I promise you, I didn't. I did not want to look back because I knew something was wrong. And when I looked back, there was this little girl standing at the door with long hair. She had on a Gap shirt, and she had on some blue jeans, and she had on tennis shoes. And she had her head down, and her hair was on both sides of her face, where you could see her face, but you couldn't see her eyes. And Miss Pat, being the loving person that she is, she walks up to the little girl and says, hey, baby, are you okay? Do you need something? And the girl looks up, and she has these black eyes, like completely, not the black voided eyes, like there's no eyeball there, but black eyes where there's no white in your eye, in the eye. And as she's telling me the story, she's stopping in the middle of telling me the story and praying while she's telling me the story. And she proceeds to say that she backs away from the door, and she's in shock because this little girl with these black eyes is standing there staring at her. And as she thinks to go to close the door and slam it, the girl steps in and closes the door behind her. Well, she passes out, blacks out on the floor, wakes up 4 or 5 hours later. It's dark outside, and she goes upstairs to get in the bed because she's like, oh, my God, I don't know what happened to me. I don't know what's going on. And she thinks she's just imagined this whole thing. As she goes to bed, and she's laying in the bed, falls asleep, and then kind of wakes up, kind of startled out of sleep. And you know how you wake up and start rubbing your eyes, you're trying to see what's going on?
Oh, yeah.
She's staring at the doorway, and as she's looking at the doorway, she sees a figure moving towards her. Freaking out again, she tells me, in the middle of telling me the story, she stops and she starts praying in the middle of telling me the story. And I'm like, man, you know, this is really doing a lot to you, Miss Pat. She's like, darling, I can't do anything, but I want to share this story with you so people will know what's going on. And she was like, I trust you and I love you, and you've always been awesome. You're a great father. And so she's really opening her soul up to me. Now she's crying while she's telling me a story and praying. And she says, I'm laying in the bed and I'm pretty much frozen. And this little girl walks up to me and touches me on my big toe. And I'm like, well, what happened? She was like, nothing. That's it. She backed away. I jumped up. I turned on the light. She wasn't there anymore. And I was like, well, what happened? And she said, well, after that, I started feeling sick. And I started having different illnesses. She had diabetes, but her diabetes got worse. She started getting, I think she said it was necrosis of the foot, which is where your portion of your foot starts rotting. Her diabetes started fluctuating. Her blood sugar level started fluctuating so rapidly, the doctor said they didn't know what was going on with her. She started having problems with her vision. Well, one of her eyes, she started losing vision in one of her eyes. Then it would come back, and then she started losing it. And so she went through a whole bunch of drama associated with having this encounter with this black eyed kid. And it got so bad that just recently she moved out of that apartment, and she actually moved next to a church. And she gets up in the morning, goes to church, leaves church, come back home, does what she is. She spends the majority of her time in church now because that's how much this encounter has frightened her. So that's like the worst black eyed kid story that I've heard, and I've heard several, but that is the worst, because I've never heard one where it actually got in the house. Most stories, like, and I think 90% of them are made up. They're like, oh, the black eyed kid came to my door and scared me.
Yeah.
I think 90% of the stuff people are making up. And what I can say is I don't make up anything. Everything I do, I get because I talk to people, and that's what makes it so good. And again, just as I told you that story, my focus is always on the person, and it's always about the emotion that the person is feeling and what happens to them. Or that dog man or the Bigfoot, they're just the antagonist in the story, and that's it.
Yeah.
And I think that's what really gets the point across.
So has that lady gotten better since she's moved to the church?
She hasn't had anything since she moved next to the church. Since she moved from that place, she hasn't had any negative experiences at all. But she's going to church pretty much all day. You know how in the black community there's church early in the morning. There's like early morning worship service, then there's Bible study in the evening, then there's midday service, then there's evening service. That's just how it is in the community. So she's going to church all day, and she feels protected. And I really believe that when it comes to, and no, I don't believe, I've been taught, and I think that's the better way to say it, I've been taught that belief plays such a significant role into your encounter with the paranormal that it's really about what you believe and how firm your belief is that dictates how your experience was with the paranormal. Now, as far as a dogman or a Bigfoot, which is a true living entity, you can believe in dogman or not, but he's still going to eat you. You can believe in Bigfoot or not, but he still might rip your arms off and ram your head against a tree. But when you start talking about ghosts and black-eyed kids and these other things, I really think it boils down to what you believe and how firm you believe in what it is that your power source that you lean on. And again, that goes back to what I was saying about the faith level, because these are the lessons that I'm learning, and all these things are important.
So now, you haven't been getting Bigfoot reports in the city of New Orleans, have you?
No. Bigfoot reports in the city of New Orleans.
It's too big, I would think.
Yeah, I mean, if there was a Bigfoot running around in the city of New Orleans, man, that would be all over the news. No, we haven't had anything like that. So the Bigfoot reports are coming out of Ohio. They're coming out of Mississippi. They're coming out of outside of Slidell, Louisiana, which is, Slidell is like a 45-minute ride from New Orleans. It's coming from the wooded areas, which are outside of the city, outside of the urban area. And the Bigfoot encounters are something that I think are very interesting, and it's kind of, it's good to kind of contrast Bigfoot versus Dogman, right?
Yeah.
I label Dogman the crypto terrorist because it has a way of terrorizing people. Bigfoot, on the other hand, from all the stories that I've gathered and all the people that I've talked to and all the eyewitnesses that I've talked to, it really, really just wants you to mind your business. It has no interest in being bothered with you. It's not trying to chase you down. It's not trying to do you anything at all. You just so happen to be in its area, and if it's aggressive, it wants you out of that area, right? And that's pretty much what I've, pretty much every encounter that I've talked to people about, that has been the story. Now, there have been one or two stories where people have assaulted Bigfoot, and especially the ones where they've tracked, thinking they were tracking a human being, where they tracked the baby Bigfoot and ended up in their territory where things didn't go very well. But again, you're following someone's kid home. That's like if someone followed my kid or your kid home, and we're sitting at home on the porch and some strange guy is walking behind our kid. You know, that's going to be a whole nother, it's going to escalate relatively quickly. So the Bigfoot encounters are coming from outside of the urban areas. And the, I guess the closest thing to an urban area where people are really, really always around that I have one is I heard one about a Bigfoot that was coming to a rest stop in Mississippi. And the Bigfoot would come to the rest stop, and it would go through the garbage cans, and it would go back into the woods. And so people were seeing this Bigfoot, but it was just the security guards. It never did anybody anything. It didn't throw anything at anybody. It wasn't exciting. It didn't do anything crazy. It just would come dig in a garbage can, get food, and leave. And that's pretty much the personality of these creatures. Not saying that they're cuddly bears that you go try and talk to, because it's a 12-foot, 10-foot, huge muscular being, and you don't need to go out looking for it, but at the same time, as long as you leave it alone, you'll be fine.
Yeah. Can I ask, what's your take on then, you don't want to go to a haunted house, or you're staying away from that area. What's your take on the investigators, like the haunted house, they're looking, ghost hunters, as we'd say, or stuff like that? Do you think that what they're doing is good then, or is it something they shouldn't do?
No, I think what they're doing is a great work for humanity. I really do. It's just no preference, right? I think that it takes every kind of personality, every type of person to make this world spin. And I give kudos to those guys that actually buy these haunted locations and they go out looking for these things, because they're bringing back relevant information that lets us know about the afterlife. And there's nothing wrong with that. We need to know about what happens after we're gone. We need to know about what's going on in the afterworld. But I personally don't feel like I need to go out and find that out for myself. I can find out from them. So I think what they're doing is a great work. I think it's one of those things that it takes a lot of, you have to be a brave person to put yourself in that situation. And I will never say that I'm a coward in any sense, but at the same time, when it comes to that particular thing, it's just not something I want to put myself in a situation where I can have such a negative experience to where it would change my life, right? And there's all these life-altering experiences we have. You know, you have a child, that's a life-altering experience. You have a baby, it's a life-altering experience. You have a car accident, that's a life-altering experience. There are enough, in my opinion, there are enough things that go on a daily basis that are dramatic enough for me that I don't need to go out looking for that particular type of drama. And going back to Sabiza's, even when I was in Sabiza's, I think I've told this story to people, when I was in Sabiza's, the ghost of Mary, I was being kind of bold and stood under a chandelier, and Graham said, hey man, you shouldn't stand under the chandelier. I'm like, no, I'm standing under the chandelier. And he's like, I'm telling you, you're standing in Mary's space, and the lights are flickering above my head on this one chandelier, not the lights in the whole room, just this chandelier is flickering. And I'm like, okay, so you guys set up some kind of pressure plate or sensor, you know, blah, 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 blah. I'm talking trash to Graham, and he's like, man, I'm telling you, you're in Mary's space. When she manifests, that's where she manifests at. Didn't believe him because I hadn't seen the pictures. And honestly, I hadn't seen the pictures yet. So I did not believe him. So I leave out of the space. I go back into the space under the chandelier because I wanted to see. My body was starting to sweat while I was under there, and I wanted to see if it was just because I was hot, because I'm a little bit overweight. I ate a few too many hamburgers, right? So, yeah. And I've been working out, but I wanted to make sure it wasn't my body just being hot because I walked a couple of blocks there. I'm like, maybe I could be hot. I just want to step from under the space and then go back. So I went back under the space, and I started feeling the same thing. At that point in time, I'm like, okay, maybe I should move. Just as I'm thinking I should move, I feel a little tug at my back pants pocket by my wallet. And I know it's a tug. I know what it feels like when someone pulls on your pants, right? It's almost like you walk in with your girlfriend, and she grabs you. She sticks her finger in the back of your jeans pants in the pocket in a corner where the seam is and tugs. Like, hey, I'm over here. That's what it was like. Like someone was tugging me to leave. And so I stepped out of the space as we're walking out of the doorway leading to where we were supposed to go up these steps where she supposedly hung herself. The lights flicker, all the lights in the room flicker. And at that point in time, I'm like, okay, bro, we're going downstairs and I'm going to leave. And so when we get downstairs, she's like, hey, you know, I want to show you some of the evidence we've gathered. And I tweeted these pictures out there on my Twitter account. And the picture was of Mary, which was a woman, long black hair, in a dress, barefooted. She had this kind of glowing kind of yellowish glowing eyes right under the chandelier. This picture was taken during a tour where there were 20, 30 people in the room. They were all leaving out of the room at that point in time. And someone turned back and snapped the picture, and they caught this manifestation of the ghost Mary. And so, of course, what I did, me being me with my personality, is I walked from the back of the restaurant, through the restaurant, past the bar, and out of the front door. And I stood outside the front door, and Graham was still sitting in the back of the restaurant where the kitchen is, where the food is served. And I yelled back in. I said, hey, bro, you need to come outside and talk to me. He was like, what? I said, you need to come outside because I'm not coming back in there. And so we finished our talking outside, and I haven't set foot back in there since. I'm not doing it. Makes no sense. I know that there's a ghost there. Why would I go back in there? And that's just my preference, you know?
Yeah.
People think it's funny, but hey, I'm not doing it.
No, I don't blame you. And so do you think people should be looking or trying to find these, like, you know, dog men and Bigfoot and all that? What's your thought?
Okay, so when we talk about Bigfoot, I think there's enough evidence out there for you to know that Bigfoot exists, right? I mean, there's the Patterson-Gimlin film. There's just type in Bigfoot on YouTube, and it's like all this evidence, right? There's even some of the freakiest evidence I've ever seen was someone caught Bigfoot chasing after their car inside of their rear view camera, you know, the little backup camera that's on the back of your car. They caught a picture of that, a photo of that, right? So we know it exists, hands down. There's been a Native American accounts of it for centuries, right? So should someone go out look for Bigfoot? It's their personal preference. I don't feel it's as dangerous as it is going out for dog man. Now, when we switch to the other side of the coin, and we start talking about dog man, I don't personally believe that anybody should be out looking for these things, because what I've discovered, and a big part of the reason why I'm pivoting away from dog man seriously, is because at some point in time, you get to a point to where there's a belief in something, you're skeptic, and then you believe. And then you get to a certain level of truth. And at that level of truth, you have a fundamental understanding. What I've come to understand about these particular creatures is this. Number one, they're extremely territorial. And number two, they're aggressive. And finally, number three, if you assault these creatures in any way, shape, or form, which we as human beings have no way of comprehending what offends them, because they're not talking to us. They're not going to say, hey, bro, you offended me, right? But if you offend or assault these creatures in any way, these creatures are extremely aggressive to the point that where they will track you to your house, and there have been people who come up missing, there have been all kind of crazy things that have happened because people have crossed these creatures' paths. So what I say to the people who are dogman researchers, which I talk to a lot of them, because I'm one of the very few YouTubers who actually has a phone number where you can call and talk to him. All my subscribers, people call me all the time, and I just answer the phone. I don't care who it is. I get crazy people. I had a guy the other day who said he was a werewolf. I get all kind of stuff, right? But the researchers who call me, and they want to ask me questions. They ask me about my experiences in Taylor, Mississippi, and they ask me about the experiences of other people who have done stories on. And what I tell them is this. I know you are going there because you're skeptic and you don't believe and you possibly want to believe. I say, but this creature does not care what you believe. So if you find yourself in the middle of the woods surrounded by the wolf or dog type with the hawks, it's not just one of them, it's six of them. So if you find yourself in that situation, yes, you've got the proof and the evidence that you want, but how are you going to get out with it? What are you going to do when it, you know, it's going to eat you. And so now you got the evidence, but you sacrifice your life for evidence that at the end of the day, nobody's going to see. Then I tell them the other scenario. Let's say you do get the evidence and you do get away. Let's say you're Arnold Schwarzenegger and Predator, right? You know, you can shoot fire arrows. You know, you put mud all over your body. You're hiding your heat signature. I mean, you are the man. It's going down. You can handle this, right? And you get away with it. You get out. Now you go public with the evidence. How many people do you think really going to really either care or believe? So it's like, essentially, you're risking your life for what? Nothing. Then I take it to the third level, and I tell people, and this is the most important level. I said, okay, we live in the United States of America. This is where a lot of this dog man activity is happening. One of the greatest empires in the history of the world. Technology 50 years beyond what we know, right? We know that there's technology now, but, you know, there's technology that they're saving that we know nothing about. Our skies are monitored by drones. Your phone calls are listened to. There's this overwhelming technology. And for you to assume that your government does not know that this exists is foolish. So let's say you go out, you get the evidence, you got everything. You got GoPro pictures. You got all the rest of the stuff you could ever get. You got away from Dog Man. Now you got some other people looking for you because they don't want people to know about this. And they don't want that information out there. So it's just a losing proposition on all levels. So when I say to people who want to go out looking for Dog Man who feel like they're going to save the world by finding this information, I say to them, there's a reason why some stuff is kept secret. And that reason why things are kept secret is sometimes the truth is far more terrifying than what you can ever imagine. So to those people who want to research Dog Man, that's my warning to them. Sometimes the truth is way worse than what you think it is. And some truths, you know, you just need to leave alone. Yeah. Leave it as entertainment. And that's what I tell people about Dog Man. I say, hey, that's one of the things that you really need to leave in the realm of entertainment. I said that on Coast to Coast, the largest syndicated talk show in the world. I was like, hey, you guys need to leave that in the realm of entertainment. Yeah. Because there's some things that you just don't need to go chasing after, you know?
Yeah. Okay. Well, we're coming to the end of the time. So how about giving out your contact information and YouTube channel?
Absolutely. First of all, before I do that, thank you. I really enjoyed this interview with you. I think the world of it. You've given me this opportunity. And I'm always humbled by having opportunities to share with people's audiences. And I hope that everyone enjoyed it. I can be found on YouTube at The Dark Waters Channel. THE Dark Waters Channel. On Twitter is at DarkH201. On Facebook is at DarkH201. And by Monday, the website will be DarkH201.com. And you guys can find all the information you want there. The next, you may be interested in this. In the next set of series, I'm going to do something that nobody's ever done. I'm trying to do 30 straight days of Bigfoot stories. And I'm trying to do it across multiple channels, across multiple venues, on AM radio stations, on podcasts. And I'm trying to just gather this large group of people to do, kind of turn June into a Bigfoot bonanza month, to where every year June is all about Bigfoot. So that's going to be very exciting. I have some seriously spooky, scary Bigfoot stories and some very revealing stories from people who actually some people tried to hunt Bigfoot. That didn't go well at all. That ended terribly bad. So it would be very interesting if people tune in and take a listen.
Ah, that sounds good. Well, thank you very much.
All right, I appreciate you. Look forward to talking to you again soon.
Show is over for now.
Was it as good for you as it was for me?
Well,
Good night.
This has been a production of the Z-Talk Radio Network.
I'll be back.